Hello, today in this video I want to show you how to fight against the Italian with the help of one very interesting gambit called the Evans Gambit. So after e4, e5, knight f3, knight c6, bishop c4, bishop c5, white is moving now b4. What is the idea of this move b4? And why white is ready to sacrifice a pawn for this. The idea is to transpose into some kind of the lines of the in Italian when you played c3, for example, knight f6, d4. Now the problem is that even if it seems that white has now this very nice center, after bishop b4, the pawn is hanging, and now, of course, there's a few possibilities like knight c3 or bishop d2, but after bishop d2, white actually cannot maintain his very nice center, because now after d5, black has actually a very nice game, white has isolated pawn, and here with this line, white is actually trying to create this nice center without allowing this idea with knight f6 and d5. And now, when black takes, white is playing the move c3. The game which I will show you was played almost 200 years ago, but it doesn't take anything from her quality, because those were probably the best players in the world at that time, Louis de la Bourdonnais and Alexander MacDonald. And this game is from their very famous match, in which Le Bourdonnais managed to win with 8 wins and 3 defeats and 7 draws. It was played in 1834. Now, black has two main possibilities, bishop to a5 or bishop to e7. After bishop c5, of course, this will only help white to push d4 with the tempo. So in this game, MacDonald went bishop a5. Now white usually can play two or three different ideas. Queen b3 is a very popular idea to attack on f7. But then black can defend with his queen. He can play d4 immediately, but after pawn takes, he is unable to take back because the bishop is pinning the pawn, or he can castle. In this game, Louis de la Bourdonnais decided to castle. And now black also has a few possibilities. He can develop the knight to e7, to f6, or he can play d6 with the idea to develop the light square bishop. Now he goes d6, and after d4, this is one of the most common positions in the Evans Gambit, in which white managed to build his nice center. He managed to castle, so he has slightly better development, but of course he is a pawn down. And the question is, how strong is his initiative, and does he has a good compensation for the pawn, or black can develop without problem and to castle. Now black has to choose what to do. He can play knight f6, or he can go bishop to b6, or he can take on d4. Probably those are the best possibilities for black. I think knight f6 is maybe the best move, because if white takes, now let's say black can take with the pawn, and in case of queen takes, black can take even with a knight, and yes, white will take the pawn back. But after, for example, castle or bishop e6, the game is equal, and black don't have big problems. But of course, many people, when they take this pawn, they don't want to give the pawn away so easily, and of course also white is not forced to exchange the queens. He can simply play queen a4, or queen b3, or bishop g5. Anyway, in this game, MacDonald decided to take on d4, which I think is maybe not the best possibility. And here, white can choose between pawn takes and queen b3. I think queen b3 was maybe a good possibility, with the idea to attack the pawn. And only when the queen moves, then white could have taken on d4 with the idea bishop g5 or e5 if the queen goes to f6, for example. When white takes, now you have the idea e5. And if he takes, of course, you just take, and bishop b2 is coming. And I think here white has a very strong initiative after queen b3. But also it's possible, of course, to take with the pawn, like Le Bourdonnais did. Now again, I think black has to develop the knight somewhere to e7 or to f6. But he went bishop to b6, which seems like a normal move, putting pressure on the pawn on d4 and maybe preparing in the future bishop to g4. And now white has to decide how to continue with his development. He can play knight c3, which is maybe the most natural move, or he can pin the knight with the bishop. But he had a very interesting idea, Le Bourdonnais, who seems a little bit maybe strange, to push d5. Now, it seems that you are closing your own bishop. Also, you are opening the diagonal for the dark square bishop of black. But actually, the idea is that after knight f5, which happened in the game, he is moving the bishop away to d3. And now the knight on a5 is a little bit out of the game. And also when white has pushed d5, he will open the big diagonal for his own bishop. So then he can go bishop to b2, and this will be a very good square for the bishop. Now black is developing. And white is developing as well, knight c3. Black goes castle. And here even white has found the time for a prophylactical move, which is the move pawn to h3. The idea is to prevent the bishop to g4. But not because bishop g4 is so dangerous for white, but simply this actually is it reminds me of positions in the modern Benoni, where white has the pawn on c4 and black has, of course, slightly different pawn structure. But the idea is the same, that actually you want to take away most of the squares from this bishop. He cannot go to e6, f5, g4. So when black has to develop his minor pieces, he will experience some problems now. First of all, the knight is on a5. Now the bishop has to go to d7. Exactly this has happened in the game, bishop to d7. And now already white has many possibilities. He can play rook to b1 to control this file. He can play rook e1. And sometimes he can prepare even e5. He can play bishop to b2 or bishop to g5. But now if you put the bishop on b2 when the knight is on c3, obviously he will be not so active. It is possible, but you have to move the knight to e2, maybe to g3, and then to try to create something on the king side. But also, when the black bishop is not on e7, usually it's very unpleasant for black when you pin now the knight on f6, because he cannot move the queen. And basically now, if you think what black can do, it is not much. He cannot move the knight, the queen, the knight, the bishop, the other bishop. So there are not so many useful moves. He goes h6, and white is keeping the pin. And here black has to take some decision what to do. Probably he has to play rook e8, or maybe bishop c5, and then some kind of a6, b5, some kind of ideas like this to improve his position. But he decided to play the move g5, which is extremely risky. Now white can choose between actually, of course, few possibilities. And the interesting fact is that actually all of them are good. Bishop g3 is a good move. There is a move even e5, which deserves serious attention. But the most simple was the move of the Le Bourdonnais, knight takes g5. This is a very common way to fight with such a move like g5, to sacrifice a piece in order to keep the pin, and now for black is very difficult to protect the knight. He can now move the king to g7 or the bishop to d4. Bishop d4 looks like is maybe a better move because it attacks the knight, and as well as bringing the bishop on the diagonal. Actually, the thing which black wants to achieve is to defend the knight with something, and so he will be enabled to move the queen away from the pin and then to remove the knight. If he can do this, he will be safe, but it's not so easy to do this, because now the problem is that after bishop d4, which was played in the game, Here there is nothing wrong with rook c1, but Le Bourdonnais has found even a better move, which is very good from his side. Now he played knight e2, and simply he is attacking the bishop. And now black has to take, because if he don't take, if he goes there to e5, f4 is coming. If he goes back, then he just lost two moves for nothing. So now he takes. Already, black is actually a rook up. We have three pieces for three pieces and two rooks for one. But the pressure on f6 is extremely strong. Black has to try to defend it with the king. So temporary, black is defending. But the problem is that he cannot bring any other piece to help. The knight is too far away, the rook cannot go to e5 very easy. And now white has to put more pressure on the knight. How can he do it? He can move the knight to g3. This is one of the possible moves. Knight g3 with the idea to give check. And I think this was also very good, because now I don't see exactly how black can defend. He has to stop this check, so he has to move the rook there. But now after e5, if pawn takes, queen takes, again there is no queen e7, there is no other way for black to defend, and knight e4 is coming. So this was a good idea, but f4 is also a very simple plan. f4 with the idea to push e5 and then e6 and to collect all the pieces on the road here. And now what to do for black? I don't think that there is some good defense. He decided to move the queen to e7 and to play maybe rook e8 if he has this time, and to try to stop the move e5. And again, from here there are a lot of good possibilities, like knight g3, even rook f3, and rook g3 is a very interesting idea to bring the rook to g3 and then simply to take with the bishop. But Le Bourdonnais decided to bring the queen there to keep an eye on the knight. And only after b6 he decided to go rook f3. And now already, for black it's impossible to prevent this idea of rook g3 and bishop f6. So he decided to confuse his opponent with this move, knight c4, but now of course white can take the knight, he can play rook g3, he can take on f6, everything is winning. In the game, Le Bourdonnais took on f6. And after queen f6, MacDonald took the bishop, and after rook g3 he had to resign, because now after king somewhere, queen f6, and then there is a checkmate coming. So this was very beautiful game, and somehow very simple for white, in which you saw how to get an active position in this deviation of the Evans Gambit, where black goes bishop to a5. So now let's move 12 years later only, in 1836, and again this guy, Louis Le Bourdonnais, is playing with white, but this time against another opening, a French guy, who is named Boncourt. And black is playing now not bishop a5, but bishop e7, which is the other best move for black. Now again white can choose between d4 and queen b3, and in this case queen b3 actually makes somehow more sense, because the black queen cannot go to e7 or f6 to defend the pawn on f7, and the only possibility for black is knight h6. And now white goes d4. Of course the idea is simply to take the knight and then to take on f7. And now the best move for black is knight f5. And this is interesting that even nowadays the theory hasn't moved and found something better than this. Even 200 years after this game, this is still the best move for black. The idea is of course that black wants to exchange the bishop, and now after queen to a4, black takes, and then white takes, and then black takes on d4. And now white has to choose between simply pawn takes d4, or bishop takes h6. And the choice is not so easy, because the bishop seems to be stronger than the knight on h6. So some people think that there is no point to take this knight. From the other hand, if you give black time, he can try to go sometimes maybe knight g4, knight f6. to regroup a little bit. So if you take now, this is a long-term weakness which black has now that his king side is exposed. So this is what happened. Le Bourdonnais took the knight, and now he took the pawn. And here black is a pawn up, but this pawn is a double pawn on h6. White is ahead in his development. He has a nice center. He can now castle and to go knight c3, the rook's in the center, two pawns in the center. So I think white has a very good compensation. And it is more easy to play this position for white because you have a clear plan to develop your pieces. As for black, it is not exactly clear what he has to do. He can play d6 or c6, but then what to do with the king? If you castle, he is a little bit exposed. If you don't castle, then he has to stay in the center where it is not also very safe. So black goes rook to g8, which is even nowadays considered as one of the best moves for black. Now white castles. And black goes d6. And now after d6, black wants to go bishop h3. So white can either move the king, like Le Bourdonnais has played, king h1, but also it was possible to play knight c3 and simply to meet this move with knight e1. Because after this, when you move the king, the bishop has to move, so he is kind of wasting time. And knight e1 is not such a useless move because it could prepare f4 after this. But king h1 is also a good move. And now this guy, Boncour, he has found a very original idea as well. He played queen d7, so he wants to go sometimes to g4 and to attack the g2. White is developing. Black goes c6 to protect his pawn and to stop knight d5. And here this is the moment where white already managed to develop his pieces. And he has to do something active. It could be the rook e1, or he has to push some pawns. But if he plays e5, black will play d5, and he will block the center. So Le Bourdonnais has realized that it's much better to push the other pawn to d5, and then already later you can try to push e5 and to open the e-file, to bring the rooks there, and to attack the king who is left in the center. But now, black has played a very original move, rook take g2. What is the idea of this move? Of course, the idea is that if you take, there will be check from here, and then there will be check from here, and then bishop h3 is coming, and suddenly black will checkmate the white king very quickly. I don't know if Le Bourdonnais have seen this in advance when he played d5 or not. Probably he has seen it because he found a very nice refutation, which is the move rook to g1. And he simply said, okay, you took the pawn, but actually you have managed to open the g-file in my favor. And now, of course, if you take rook g1 is coming, and then white has the g-file. Probably the best move was rook to g4, but black decided to take another pawn. He thought maybe why not. This is a free pawn, and if white goes rook g8, black will move the bishop to f8, and then he can bring the queen to h3, which will attack the knight, which will attack the h2 pawn. And here white has to find again a very strong grip y, and he found it, which is the move rook to g3, defending against queen h3, defending the knight, and now already he can play sometimes even king g1. And it will be interesting to see exactly where this rook will move, because he doesn't have too many free squares on the second rank. And also now, of course, rook e1 is possible. Again, he can follow his plan to push e5 and to open the e-file. And here already white has a very huge advantage, because for black it's very difficult to develop his queen side. You can see the bishop is closed, the rook is closed, he cannot castle. So he decided to push c5. So probably to try to somehow develop, if he has time, to play maybe a6, b5, or bishop b7. And now this is very important to attack immediately, and not to give this time to black to somehow move his pieces away, maybe the queen away, to bishop d7 and castle. So immediately white has to push e5. And of course, if black takes with the pawn, knight xc5, and then you have rook e1 coming, or queen b5 check, or there are plenty of ideas. Black preferred to play b6, hoping to play bishop b7 and then eventually castle. And here white already has, by the way, few good possibilities. The best move was simply knight e4, and then the idea is rook g8 check and knight f6. So probably, of course, this is losing rook b2 because rook g8 check and knight f6, so probably he has to sacrifice. But then, of course, white has a winning position. But white preferred to follow his plan. He decided to develop the other rook. How they are saying, let everyone join the party. And now black has to move the king away to try to hide. And after e6, black has to take. White took with the pawn, so in order to free the square d5 for his knight. And now if queen c6, there will be knight d5, and then black cannot prevent this checkmate. That's how he went to e8, at least to stop this check. And now white can play again many moves, even king g1 is interesting move to attack the rook. But knight d5 is the most natural move. And after bishop b7, now black has closed the center now, the files are blocked, so white has to take another route. And he decided to go rook to g1, with the idea simply to go, of course, rook to g8 and to take the queen. Now black decided to take the knight, so at least he can move his king to c7. And now, after rook g8, he can simply take. And then already actually black will have a very strong attack if he has rook on g8 and rook on f2. Or rook f1 check is coming. So in this case, this will be a mistake to go to g8, and white has to go to g7, simply to pin the bishop. Now white wants to even take on e7 and take on a8, so black has to move the rook. He went to c8, and now he wants to move maybe the king to b8 and to free the bishop a little bit, although not entirely, since queen b7 is also coming. And now white has to put even more pressure on the bishop, so he goes rook f7 with the idea to defend the knight and to bring the other rook to g7. And black don't have any defense against this. He has to move the king, but after rook to g7 he cannot move the bishop because of queen b7 checkmate. And if he plays rook c7, this is also not helping too much because now white can take. And after rook takes e7, queen d6 check, and white also is winning. So black decided at least to avoid the immediate checkmate, to exchange the queens. And then white has to go into this endgame. Now rook e7. Black takes the knight. But now the problem for black is that the pawn on e6 is very strong. If rook e8, there will be rook c8. It is not winning immediately, but first rook b7 check. Now the king has to go to c8 to avoid the checkmate, but if he goes there, white also can take. And after king c8, white first take this pawn. Now he wants to checkmate from here. This is not helping because, of course, king g2. The only defense is king to b8. And then again, Le Bourdonnais has gave another check. This time black went to a8. It's not so important because now rook f7. White could have done this on the previous move as well. The idea is to deliver checkmate. And now black has to take. And then after pawn takes, of course, white is winning. So here, after rook g8, black has resigned. So this was another good example from Louis de Le Bourdonnais, where he shows how to play in the Evans Gambit. We saw against both main possibilities, bishop a5 and bishop e7. Few good attacking ideas. So I hope that you have enjoyed the video and see you next time.